Father, thank you for Matt. Thank you, Lord God, for the word that you've laid on his heart. And I pray, Lord, this morning as he shares that our hearts would be open, that we'd hear what you have to say to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Can you all hear me? Fantastic. Fantastic. Okay, so welcome and to hopefully a very sunny Sunday today. Oh, please, 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 please. So when I came up to Brian a few months ago saying that I wanted to preach again and that I had this preaching idea that I was very excited to talk about, if I'm being honest, I did say, I just don't want to preach into a camera again. I want to have people in the room. So church is not as we know it quite yet. We are allowed to have 50 people in the room, and for those that want to watch remotely online, they can sit on their couch and still do so. So for that, I am really grateful, and I'm grateful that it's going to be a very sunny day today. And it's a good thing that I am grateful, because the title of my sermon today is called The Two Weapons of War, Gratitude and Encouragement. The Two Weapons of War, Gratitude and Encouragement. And if you're thinking to yourself, that's a very interesting title for a sermon, thank you. I think it is too. And we will be talking about why I chose that title later on. So what we're going to be doing today is that we're going to look at gratitude and we're going to look at encouragement. And we're going to hopefully, by the end of this day, be a little bit more grateful and a little bit more encouraged than when we started this day. So, first, gratitude, to be thankful. Now, in this life, we have so much to be thankful for. We, in the day-to-day monotony, can pass up on so much that we take for granted, quite frankly. Did you know that Canada is ranked the number one for quality of life in the world in 2020 for the fifth year in a row? It's a great place to live. Now, maybe you're listening to this message and you're thinking to yourself, yeah, gratitude's great and Canada is pretty cool, but I have X, Y, or Z problems in my life right now, and what you're saying is not fixing those things. And it's true. You're right. But what I am trying to say is that I'm not saying that we ignore those issues. Whatever it is, should and I hopefully can be dealt with. But what matters is this. You magnify what you focus on. Right, Tina? Wherever you are? Yeah. Yeah. And that's important. Maybe I don't have a floor beneath my feet, but at least I have a roof over my head. Maybe I don't have shoes on my feet, but at least I have a shirt on my back. Maybe I find it hard to love myself right now, but I know that Jesus loves me. Maybe I lost my job, but at least I have a church community that I can come to for help. Whatever your lack is, there's something else that we can still be thankful for. So to take a good look at gratitude, I'd like us to look at the negative side of it, what a lack of gratitude looks like in your life. And to do that, we're going to be looking at Romans 1:21. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile and foolish, and their hearts were darkened. So another way of saying this is that despite knowing God, despite you knowing God, your thinking can become futile, foolish, and dark because you don't glorify or thank God. Now, thinking about this, thinking about my own life. When in my life have I not been grateful to God? And I came up with two reasons that might be beneficial for us today. The first is lack of time spent with God. So think of this like a relationship, like a marriage. Okay? So are you grateful and thankful for your spouse when, let's say, you only spend time with them for a few hours on a Sunday morning, like some Christians do? No, you're not grateful for. You are the most grateful and thankful for your spouse when you're taking on each day together, overcoming challenges together, and enjoying life together. The exact same thing is true for Jesus. The second is disrespectful of his gift. The gift that Jesus gives us is amazingly insane. More grace and love and mercy than you could ever fathom. Jesus snatching us from the jaws of hell so that we can spend eternity with him. That's the gospel. That's his gift to us. And yet, knowing this, I can make choices or I can say things that are disrespectful and dishonors that gift. Now, what I'm not saying is that Jesus' gift of grace is not powerful enough to overcome anything that we do. You can do the most heinous thing up your sleeve, and his love will still be there for you. His grace will still be there for you. However, if I'm doing something that I know will sadden God, it just is naturally harder to look up to heaven and say, thank you for your grace, Father. It just is. So, for me, I'm more grateful and more thankful to God when I'm spending the time with him and when I'm respecting what he has given me. Okay, so what else is futile and foolish thinking that comes with no gratitude? Well, it's bitterness, it's greed, it's pride, it's entitlement. Think of it this way. Will a bitter and greedy man sincerely say, thank you, I'm grateful for, and I really appreciate? He will not. To help illustrate this, I'm going to say a quick thing that happened, that was said to have happened, that was recorded, of Winston Churchill speaking with an officer in the military during World War II. Winston Churchill being, he was the great Prime Minister of Britain during one of its worst times. He was a fantastic leader. A low-level officer is said to have once told Winston Churchill, I want you to know that I am a self-made man. Churchill is said to have replied, you have just relieved God of a very solemn responsibility. So what Churchill is saying here, quite funnily I'd say, is that if you think of yourself as a self-made man and you need no one else, you're saying that God didn't do anything for you. And yet it can be further from the truth. He created you. He made you. He made everything around you. All that you are and have, whether you believe it or not or like it or not, is because of God. Any good thing. And that can go down towards other people as well. There's no self-made man in this world. He has used and garnered help from people and systems around him. So, to wrap this gratitude up, what's one of the many reasons that gratitude matters? It is a shield to futile, foolish, and dark thinking, while keeping our perspective intact, negating the rise of bitterness, greed, or pride, or entitlement within ourselves. Okay, so encouragement, to give courage, to hopefully deposit courage. courage in others. Now that we are grateful and not handicapped by those things, we can be more capable to help others. 1 Thessalonians 5:10-11 says, "He died, being Jesus, for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing." In other words, Jesus died for us, therefore encourage and build each other up. Jesus sacrificed and gave us hope, so we should help give hope to each other. Encouragement. So, Brian, I think that you have a heart for discipling and mentoring men, and I think that is amazing. And I pray that you going forward, that will go from strength to strength, and that will become more of a passion for you, and will bring excitement to your world more and more and more. And I love that about you. Or Christina, you have such a heart for worship, and I think you do a great job helping lead these worship teams. And I hope it becomes more and more exciting, just like Brian, for you as well. And I love that about you. Please continue. And I just want to, like, I'm being sincere with these, right? I want to publicly encourage to show that it's just, well, for one thing, it's a very hard thing to be in a bad mood if you're encouraging someone. And it's just, it's so awesome, you know. I believe that we are on this track already, but I think and I hope that as we double down on a spirit of encouragement within our church, who knows what's next. And, you know, if you think about it, you either negatively or positively affect those around you, whether you believe it or not or like it or not. It's true. So might as well influence them positively. And think about what kind of church you want. What kind of community do you want? What kind of environment do you want to surround yourself with? Use encouragement as a tool to help shape that reality. And look around you, please. Look at the people around you right now. Maybe it's a little awkward, especially for those introverts. But that's more fun anyways, to mess with them. So I truly believe that there is so much potential in this church and the greater church worldwide. Preaching, teaching, worshiping, mentoring, compassion, kindness, even ferocity and vigilance, etc. And I think that encouragement can be such a tool to help unlock these gifts in our communities. So I was talking with a friend about my sermon idea, and I was talking about, you know, encouragement is great because it doesn't cost anything. But he's like, hold on a second. Of course it costs. You can encourage someone with your effort, with your money, and with your time as well. I was thinking of encouragement just like a compliment. It can be far more than that. You know, maybe it's like, oh, you know, I think you're so skillful with music, so I bought you a guitar. Or, oh, you're moving. Okay, I'll go help you move this. Or, okay, you know what, I think I can help you with this particular thing. Let's spend some time together figuring it out. Encouragement can cost. It's just forewarning. But it will be good. So I was talking with another friend about my sermon idea. And she said, actually, you should title your message "The Two Weapons of War, Gratitude and Compassion." And at first I was like, wait a second, I really love my title. Are you just telling me I should change my title? And after a little sting to the pride there, I thought about it. And I'm like, okay, well, she has a great point. because there is no encouragement if there is no compassion first. You will not make that effort. You will not give that money, or you will not use that time if you don't care about the person first. And loving people is not always the easiest. For some, it's easier than others. They can be selfish. They can be annoying. They can be smelly. And it's perfectly understandable because we can be smelly. The thing is, as followers of Jesus, we're supposed to do things the way he did it and the way he said it. And it's not always going to be easy. Preparing the sermon, I just wanted to find like a magic wand type thing that would make it easy for all of us to love each other. And it's not there. But I would like to say this, and maybe this is a good starting point or jumping off point, is that I hope that we can see others the way that Jesus sees us and that the way that Jesus sees them. And, he thought it was worth it to help them. And, what about us? So another thing about encouragement is that it's not always nice. Constructive criticism, that's kind of the angle I'm taking with this right now. To help illustrate my point, I have a little story for you. So a few months ago, when COVID was really starting to ramp up, and we had to stop meeting as a church for a time, and we could only broadcast it out on a Sunday morning, Tyler Hall and I, who had started not so long before that a new life group in the church, decided that as a small life group, we'd meet together on Sunday mornings to watch the message together. And during that time, I think it was maybe 3 weeks in a row, I arrived late for church to partake together. Not the worst thing in the world, but not good either. So, one or two people found that funny. Tyler, I think it was the third weekend, after church ended, in front of everyone, just grabbed me by the scruff on my neck and yelled into my face, "Matt, what are you doing? You suck. Get it together." And then everyone booed and hissed. That did not happen. Tyler was quite nice about it, and it took things, and did it more wisely than that. And for that, I'm thankful. But I wanted to make the point, besides hopefully making one or two people laugh, that there is a wise way and a not-so-wise way of giving constructive criticism. Key constructive part. What Tyler did do is that when no one else was around, sat me down and was like, "Hey, I've noticed that you've been arriving late, and I think as a leader in this life group, I think you can and should do better." And I thought about it, and afterwards I acted, I think, better than what I had done the previous 3 weeks. And I talked to Tyler and Holly afterwards. I'm like, "You're right, and I'm sorry. And I'll make sure to arrive on time in the future, and thank you for having that conversation with me, because I realized that it was not comfortable for you to have that conversation. Conflict is not comfortable for most people, but that was a conversation that had to be had, and we talked about it, and there was improvement. So thank you, Tyler, and I just want to make the point that despite encouragement not always being nice, I think that when it's done in a loving manner, wanting the other person to be better afterwards, it is and should be done. Okay, so weapons of war. The two weapons of war, gratitude and encouragement. So I could have just titled the sermon Gratitude and Encouragement, but I really wanted to drive 2 points home today about these things. The first is that we are at war. Now, I've decided to pull out 3 main battlefronts that we are at war with. A, the war for our mind. The war for our mind. As we all know, everything that goes on up here is not always holy. Christians absolutely included. So, to help us understand this, I want you guys to think about when someone becomes a new Christian, it's as if they are adopted into God's family, okay? And when that happens, they immediately share in the eternal inheritance of Jesus and God and get all those benefits. But like many adopted children, they still have some baggage from their previous life. Anger issues, lust issues, control issues, fear issues. Oftentimes, it's not left fully behind. But the cool thing is that Jesus loves us too much to only bring us into his family and then leave us there. Despite it sometimes hurting, Jesus intends to remove whatever will inhibit our healing process. The Bible has a fancy word for this called sanctification, the renewing of our minds. And this is the fight that we have in our brains every day. And I pray that it can go from glory to glory. B, the second war front, the war with the ways of this fallen world. This world is not as it began. And it's not yet restored to glory. And for the time being, Jesus follows a path that is counterintuitive and against the grain of the natural order of the earth right now. It's just the way it is. And if you feel that friction sometimes, usually it just means you're actually following Christ. C, the war with the devil, the third battlefront. Now, the Bible tells us that he's real and wishes us destroyed. Now, I do not want to give him more airtime than absolutely necessary, because the Bible also tells us he will be defeated in the end. I think fearing the devil is something that we have to watch out for. Fearing him too much, I should say, and attributing to him too much can be an issue at times. I will say this for sure, though. We have a big, big God, and he, in perspective, is a very small, small problem. He is there, and we need to be aware of it, but don't give him more power than absolutely necessary. So, the second point I really wanted to make with my title is that gratitude and encouragement are tools in our arsenal. They are gizmos on our utility belt, shall we say. Gratitude is a shield from arrows of bitterness and pride that can come our way. And encouragement is something that can spur us on each other on to be the best of ourselves. The thrust and parry of the spiritual wars that we are in need not always be one of blood, sweat, and tears. Sometimes that's required, but we can conquer with gratitude in our hearts and encouragement on our lips and a smile on our face. We can have fun doing it. So gratitude is the shield, weapon, metaphor, that's great, that I'm using right now. I was trying to think of a good weapon for encouragement, And the only one I could think of was a whip. And I'm like, that's probably not a good idea. So if you have a better idea than me about what encouragement could be as a weapon, please let me know, because I've been racking my brain. So lastly, as we're starting to wrap up here, I'd like to talk about a potential danger that can come from talking about these things. I think that gratitude is amazing and encouragement is amazing. However, if we pay so much attention to what we're doing and the tools that we can use, we can lose sight of who gave us those tools in the first place. It can almost turn into a pay it back mentality. Let me say it another way. As a Christian, if your thinking is, okay, I'm a Christian, Jesus saved me, I'm going to heaven and not hell, you know, this is amazing, I need to pay it back. I should read my Bible every day, and I should pray every day, and I should probably stop swearing, maybe I should stop smoking, you know, and then that way, you know, I'll be paying God back for what he's done for me, and then when I come to church, I can feel accepted within, and that is a process, a thought process towards destruction. Because one of two things will happen. Either you will succeed at following the rules that you have set for yourself, and you will gain so much pride, you will be blind to anything beyond your own nose, which happened to many of the Pharisees, or you will fail in the rules that you've set for yourself, and you will feel condemned and see no way out. Neither of these are good choices. What we need is, I think, more along these lines. And to help us with that, I have two scriptures for us that I will read out of the Passion Translation. Galatians 5:6 says, "When you're placed into the Anointed One and joined to him, circumcision and religious obligations." Okay, so circumcision and religious obligations. Circumcision is just a metaphor for religious obligations, okay? "Circumcision and religious obligations can benefit you nothing. All that matters now is living in the faith that is activated and brought to perfection in love." 1 Corinthians 15:10a says, "But God's amazing grace has made me who I am, and his grace to me was not fruitless." So, religious obligations. Doing I need to do all these things or else I'm not a good Christian. Mean nothing. Now, does reading your Bible every day, is that helpful? Absolutely. If you're doing it because you think you need to pay God back, there's an issue there. If you think praying every day, that's helpful too. But if you're doing it because you think you have to pay God back, that's unhelpful. All that matters is faith perfected by love. His grace makes me who I am. Love and grace. How does this come about? It's relationship. It's relationship. See, what makes Christianity engaging, exciting, healthy is when it's a growing, developing, deepening marriage with Jesus. That's what it is. It's a relationship. It's not rules. Is there helpful guidelines along the way that are tried, true, and tested that you should consider? Yes, there is. But it's the relationship. So, finishing off here, I just wanted to highlight some of the sweet tools, gratitude and encouragement, that we have at our disposal within this context of relationship with Christ this morning. And thank you guys so much for laughing at my cheesy jokes. And I hope you have a fantastic, sunny Sunday morning.
Thanks, Matt. Appreciate that. I wanted to give an example. Matt said, "Do you have any other ideas other than a whip?" Sometimes a whip is helpful. Sometimes some of us are so stubborn we don't want to hear when God speaks, so He brings out a whip and then He just gives us a little pinch, and then we say, "Well, okay, I should have listened." He does it sometimes, for sure. But encouragement for me is, think of a painting. And those that have been mentored by me and sat in any sort of leadership thing understand the saying of that discipleship is painting a picture of a preferable future for people that you are leading and then helping them get there. And saying that here is where I believe God is taking you. This is where you are right now, and there's a few things that you need to make, that you need to adjust, add to, take away from, so that we get to this picture of a preferable future, which is God's painting for you. And so maybe that's a picture of encouragement. And sometimes that encouragement means that if you don't make these few adjustments, that thing's not going to happen. But if you do, this is where God's taking you, because He has a good plan for your life. Father, we thank You for Your word. We thank You for our friend Matt. Thank You, Lord God, that You've spoken to us through him. Lord, I pray that we would indeed have hearts of compassion to see those around us through Your eyes. Thank You for these weapons of war. I pray, Lord, that we would employ them at every opportunity so we could see Your kingdom advance in our lives and the lives of those around us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Wonderful. Have a good day.